Go with the service today and be with Daryl as he brings a message to us, and continue to guide and bless this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. How about the Lily of the Valley?
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He's the lily of the valley. In him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my strength. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley. Of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken, and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world around me forsake me, the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me or yet forsake me here while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roam. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
I have a problem where sometimes my tongue gets over my eye teeth and I can't see what I'm saying. Penny.
Good morning.
Morning, Penny.
Is this working? Okay. All right. We are so glad to have each and every one of you here this morning at the Racetrack Chapel. We welcome you and we hope that you will come back. This is a place where we preach and teach and seek to become more like Christ every day. We are reading verses from the Lincoln Devotional. Today, our scripture passage comes from Romans 8, chapter 14. The title is Led by the Spirit. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. I would rephrase that, and I'd say for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the children of God, and newer translations of the scripture will tell you that. The prose under that says, lead us to holiness, the road that we must take to dwell with God. Lead us to Christ, the living way. Nor let us from his pastures stray. Lead us to God, our final rest, in his enjoyment to be blessed. Lead us to heaven, the seat of bliss, where pleasure in perfection is. We talked about that in Sunday school this morning, actually, how as children of God, we are to be the embodiment of peace and contentment, not because of what we have in the physical world, but because of what we possess in the spiritual world. I would encourage all of you to give Sunday school a try. We meet and go through this door, and we are there from 9:30 to 10:15. And this is the best way to get to know those that you're sitting with in the pews, is to be in Sunday school, to share, to hear what others have to say. If you don't want to open your mouth and say anything, you don't have to. But we all learn from others. That's how we grow spiritually. So I would encourage you to come to Sunday school. We also have children's Sunday school at 10 o'clock in the same area. We have a Spanish service here at 11:30 on Sundays. On Tuesdays at 4:30 here at the Racetrack Chapel, we have a time for the ladies to meet, get together, have coffee, and visit. And then we have a discipleship Bible study that is self-driven. It's a book at a time, and each time you finish a book, Daryl will take you to lunch to discuss the material. For birthdays and anniversaries, during this week we only have one birthday, and that's October the 3rd, Jerry Lynn Sigmund. Is Jerry Lynn Sigmund here today?
No.
Okay. If you have a bulletin, you see that there is a full list of prayer concerns. I ask that you take this and you read it and you pray over it. The one that I have chosen, feel led to mention today, is praying for our country, for unity, for God's choices to be made, for the right choices to be made in the days and weeks to come in our political realm. So let's pray. Oh Lord my God, how we love you. And it compares nothing to how much you love us, each and every one of us. Thank you for your unconditional love. Father, you created this earth and everything in it. You created the United States and everything in it. And we have failed you. And I ask that you forgive us. Give us the ability and the courage and the wisdom and the strength and the knowledge to turn our hearts back to you. Let this be a strong nation for you. Let this country be a beacon of light for you. I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Let's sing Jesus is All the World.
If this is your first time here, we have some coffee mugs at the back on the bar back there, and please feel free to take one. We want you to have them. And all we ask is that as you use them in your home and you see the church logo on the coffee cup, if you would please pray for this church and for the ministries that we do. Thank you.
Hold it. Boy, I got you quick, didn't I? We need to have one other man on our prayer list. This guy here is going for some tests over in Mayo. He's been trying for about 2 months to find out what his problems are. And we need to, let's just say a prayer for Michael right now, and then you can keep him in his prayer, in your prayers. They're leaving right after the message to head to Phoenix, out to Mayo. So, dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you so much for Michael and for what he adds to this chapter. We ask you, God. Help him to give him some comfort and find out what his problems are. Work with him to get him cured and bring him back safely to us. We trust this in you. We know that all you do all that is good for us and for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's sing Jesus is All the World. Ready now.
Jesus is all the world to me, my life, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without
careful.
He's got one more song to play.
We do.
Yes.
What are we going next?
When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Are we not? We are pretty late. You don't know it? Okay, we're done.
Wes, yes, we do. How did I get all confused here? Okay. All right, we'll do one more song. Oh, we're done. Okay. Michael, get out of here.
Landon, if he'd come up. I want to introduce you. You met Landon the other week. Landon leads the music for the Spanish service that follows us at 11:30. And he also does the youth on Wednesday night. And our kids are joining that youth group. And Romina's taking some of the smaller kids, and they meet in the back and do crafts. So we're blending together these two churches. And I stayed for the first service that they had, and Landon's playing this keyboard, and he breaks into English just for me. And he said, if your heart is burdened to where you have problems worshiping, just give that over to God. It was something along those lines. And it spoke to me. And I thought, what wisdom coming from a 15-year-old. And so I said, Landon, come and preach next week. So he's going to preach for me next week. And so I wanted you to give him maybe your title or a little bit about what you'll do.
So basically what I started planning about was that I started praying to God, just, God, what do you want these people to hear? And slowly I started looking at other people around in my church and other people's churches that they go to church, but I don't really see a deep relationship with them, so I called it Go Deeper.
Go Deeper.
Go Deeper.
Good, good, perfect. Would you lead us in a prayer as we're about to go into the sermon here?
Okay.
Please.
Lord, today and this day, we thank you for everything that you've done for us. I want to pray for every single person, every single necessity in this church, Lord. And I hope that you can open up our hearts and our minds, Lord, to receive your message, Lord. We come to your message with open arms, Lord. We want to receive and we want to learn more about you, God. In your name we pray, Lord. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much. So make sure you're here next week. Now, I hope I don't take your sermon because I have Seeking God as my sermon today. And it's getting deeper with God, too. But that's the way God works sometimes. Sometimes we need to hear it twice. Sometimes we need to hear it more often than that. Have you ever kind of felt like spiritually you're a little hard-headed? You ever feel like God is trying to get your attention and you keep kind of getting caught into the same circle? Well, that's what this sermon's about. This is about getting to know God, getting a deeper walk with him. Do you remember the show Home Alone? Kevin, I don't know his name in the show, but he was the little boy that was left at home. And his brother was Buzz. We all have a Buzz in our life, don't we? Well, Buzz had told him that the neighbor was out shoveling snow. And Buzz told him, he said, "See that man over there, our neighbor, he's the South Bend shovel slayer. And he slayed his whole family, and he puts them in that bucket of salt. That's how he gets rid of the bodies." Okay, well, then Kevin's home alone, and wouldn't you know, the first night he's alone, he bumps into this man outside the house, and he runs in terror. You kind of getting this set up? Well, see, what Buzz had told him, had that in his head about what this man was like. And it wasn't until he went to church, Kevin went to church, and when he was at church on that Sunday morning, he saw that neighbor there, and he got to see a little bit about him. He got to actually say hi to him, and if you remember in the story, he goes back and he says, "You know, he's not a bad guy. You know, he's very nice." That false impression set him up so that he couldn't look at that guy until he found out what he was really like. And see, our perception of God is somewhat similar. If we look at him like a policeman, that he's just kind of pointing his finger and waiting for you to mess up, you're going to be mixed up on who God is. A.W. Tozer says, "What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us." It's how we view him. If we have those misconceptions about God, it's going to affect the way you worship. And that's when I was sitting back there listening to Landon the other day, I was so caught up in seeing, well, what's the worship style? What's the message? What's going to be said here? I was in pastor mode instead of worship mode. You see, we got to get out of that mode, whatever we're in, whatever our perception of God, and we got to get to a place where we can open our hearts and worship him for who he is and have the right knowledge of him. You know, if we look at him like a judge, we'll never go to him for forgiveness. We'll just think, oh, guilty, I better just bury it. I better live with the things that I've done in my life instead of bringing them before God and getting free as it promises in Scripture. You know, if we keep him in a box, we never really see his power and his might and his wisdom in our life. We need to get out of that to be able to see and focus on him. If we look at him as the Creator, just too busy holding everything together, we'll never feel like he has time for me and my needs or the issues of my life. He's busy holding it all together. Tozer again, he says, "Worship is pure or base as the worshiper entertains high or low thoughts of God." And that's where we begin today. What your thought of God is. Is it just a low perception of God? Is it, yeah, he put it all together, he created me, you know, I come to church? Or is it, man, I just fall before him, understanding his greatness and his power and his might, that he knows all about me? Because you see, that wrong perception of God, worshiping the wrong God, has driven people to do terrible things. If you look at the Muslim terrorists, when they get behind a truck and mow someone over, they're doing that because they have a strong belief that this is who they think God is. That's their perception, that they think that they're doing God's will by killing others. They have a misconception of who God is. They're worshiping the wrong God. But God loves them. He wants to draw them to himself. He wants to draw all people to him through Christ Jesus. So that powerful knowing God is good. Foster says to think rightly about God is an important sense to have, the most important sense to have. To think wrongly about God is to have everything wrong. Nothing twists and deforms the soul more than a low or unworthy conception of God. So as we move forward here today, maybe get in your mind, you know, have I kind of dropped worship out of my life? Have I kind of quit seeing God for who he is? Am I just kind of using him like a genie in a bottle, calling him out when I need some help, but running my own life when everything's going smooth? Because it'll never be right. Your life will never be right until we can fall before him and say, Lord, you are my master. Lord, I am your servant here to do your will. I worship you with all my being. Because that relationship, when we walk in that relationship that he's designed for us, we become a mighty tool in God's hands, a mighty servant of his, one that he can use because he sees through our life that we're dedicated to worshiping him and serving him. If you struggle obeying his commands, it can be because of this wrong perception of God, not totally understanding his character, not knowing the God of the Bible, the true one God, the one and only. And the very first thing, the very first point is God is not like us. You know, sometimes we try to say, well, you know, God, we're created in God's image, which we are. But we are far from being close to who God is. Can't be compared that way. God is not exactly like anything or anybody. Completely different. God is so much higher. So much higher. When Christ came to earth, he was the exact representation of God himself. Sinless, holy, compassionate. Everything that you see in Jesus' life as he served here on earth, he was God in the flesh. And we can't demote him. Having that right perception of God is knowing that he's three in one. It's knowing that Christ, Jesus, is God himself. That there's God the Father, and we worship him. We worship all three. We understand that the Spirit of God is moving in this world to give us power. It is the Spirit of God. He, not a thing, not a form, not a force. This is God himself moving by his Spirit in our lives. If you want to be moved in worship, begin to ask his Holy Spirit to fall upon you and give you that kind of praise and worship in your heart. And maybe as a Baptist, you need to go up on a hill behind a tree, but get it out. Worship him with all that's in you. Give him all that's in you. When you worship like that from the depth of your being, you make that connection with the true God. You know, I was going to tell you that 11:30 service when I evaluated it, Beto. I was listening to your service. And I'm so glad you guys are here because I have a little background, assembly, charismatic. You guys wouldn't know that. Lutheran. I'm all mixed up. So I have a little bit of everything. But it reminded me of the times of my life when I worshiped like that. And it doesn't mean that we can't worship with these older hymns. It just means that we need that time, whether it be private or public, to be able to express that kind of worship. And I'd encourage you to do that. Just get up in the morning with that cup of coffee and just find a time where it's just sitting cold because you haven't touched it, because you're just worshiping God. You're making that connection with him. So some verses for you to grab hold of would be 2 Samuel 7:22. When King David is saying, "How great are you, O sovereign Lord? There is no one like you, and there is no God but you." When you read Scripture and you get those kind of verses going inside of you and you begin to really connect with God, that's when that worship will come out. And in Isaiah, when God himself says this through the prophet, "To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Lift your eyes and look to the heavens who created all these things. He who brings out the starry hosts one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom." You get the point? You start reading scriptures like that, that should drive right here. That should be touching your hearts deeply, saying, "This is the God I serve. This is the God I bow before. This is the Most High." And in Isaiah again, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." And finally in Romans, when Paul speaks in chapter 11, he says, "Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor? Who has ever given to God that God should repay him? For from him, through him, and to him are all things. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen." Can I get an amen? Isn't that good? The scripture is packed full of things that lead us, should lead us to our knees and maybe even flat on our stomachs, saying, "God, you are so good. You are so good. No one has ever known his mind. From him, through him, and to him. He never grows tired or weary. Never. Absolute and complete knowledge. He knows everything about us. He knows our hearts. He knows what you're thinking. He knows how you're going to react before you ever react, because he sees the pattern of your life. And when he puts that finger on a certain spot in your life and he says, "This needs me," that's when we need to surrender. We need to give him those areas of our life, because he knows. He knows what's best for us. And he comes after us with a love that we can't understand. Unconditional, over and over again, calling us by name, as the Bible says, calling us, calling our hearts. You know, the second thing through this lens we're looking at God through, we tend to reduce God to manageable terms. That's the second point. We shrink him, this all-knowing and all-powerful God. We want to get him in a container that we can understand. Tozer says we want to get God to where we can use him, or at least know where he is when we need him. We want a God we can, in some measure, control. Any control freaks in here? God, over and over again, reminds me that Daryl's not in control, that he is. And sometimes falling flat on my face is the way that I best understand that. We should understand this awesome God and his desire for us to do his purposes, to live for him. When Moses, when he was up on Mount Sinai, you know the story, getting the Ten Commandments. Well, Aaron, his right-hand man, under peer pressure, he reduced God to a bunch of melted-down jewelry. You know the story. This God, who had taken them out of bondage, who had destroyed the Egyptian army and separated the sea so they could walk on dry ground, how easily they were persuaded to make an idol. And we go, oh, we're not like that. Well, I'll give you a clue. We do it all the time. We think, well, God, maybe you can't quite handle this for me, so I'm going to figure out a way to fix this issue of my own life, whether it be financial or spiritual, physical, whatever it is. We leave God out of the equation. We make ourselves an idol. You know, in the second commandment, someone said rightly, sometimes we make yourselves an idol, speaking of ourselves. We can't treat God as if he's on demand, our own personal manager of him. Can't make yourself an idol. We have to know God. And that brings up that third thing. God can only be known as he reveals himself. If you look around the world at the different religions, they're trying to get to God. In Christianity, God came to us. You see the difference? God is seeking the relationship with you. He comes to us. He draws close to us. It's his initiative. In sending his own son, it's his initiative to come to us, to bring that relationship. Without God, God cannot be known. We're not going to find him if we're just out looking like that. He's already found us. He makes friends with us. And he does that through nature. If you have read a lot of scripture, you know Psalm 19 is a beautiful psalm. Says the heavens declare the glory of God. You know, we can see all around us. We can walk in the woods. We can be on top of these mountains, and we can see the beauty that God has designed in this world, and it brings us to worship. But it's not a full view of who God is. It's just that first little invitation. You want to know me? You want to know who created all this? Do you want to know who set the stars in the sky? Bringing us closer. Wiersbe said, nature preaches 1,000 sermons a day to the human heart. So you've been preached to before you ever even thought of God. He's preached to you. We observe only a partial picture, though, because it's through his word. It's through the word of God that he reveals himself in the Bible. We get to know him. We get to know his character. We get to be able to depend on him because we see what he's done in the past, and he can do that for you and I. The miracles out of Scripture, they didn't just happen then. Miracles happen each and every day. Have faith. Believe. Proverbs 2, 1 through 2 says, my son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. No, you get that by reading his word, by studying it, by memorizing it, and meditating on it. I would start there with that cup of coffee. I'm selling the cups. No. But when you have that cup in front of you, just start reading your scripture. Because when you read it with all your heart, and you begin to understand it as God puts that understanding in your heart, it's going to lead to the worship I'm talking about. It's going to lead to a right understanding of who God is. You see, children, a lot of times today, children are just set in front of a video. But that's not the best way to learn. And it's proven that when a child is read to, that they begin to imagine the story. Much more goes into that than just watching a story where you're not interacting with it. But in a book, when those words become live, that verbal communication, makes the mind and the heart work. And it's the same what we're talking about right here. When we take his word and we open it up and we dive into his word, it begins to open up for us and become alive. We begin to imagine even more and more what God is doing, what he's like, because we have it right in front of us. And he reveals himself on those pages of scripture. And when we study his word is powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword. We need to study his word. And finally, through his son. In Hebrews 1, the son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. I alluded to that earlier, but taking that scripture and really grabbing hold of it, understanding that everything that we know of Jesus and everything that we read and continue to learn in scripture is God revealing himself through Christ Jesus to the world. His spirit prompts us in our hearts and our spirits, draws us to him. John 14:9 says, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Jesus, visible and knowable, and still is. Sally Lloyd-Jones says, there are a lot of stories in the Bible, but all the stories are telling one big story. The story of how God loves his children and comes to rescue them. It takes the whole Bible to tell this story. At the center of the story, there's a baby. Every story in the Bible whispers his name. He is like the missing piece in a puzzle, the piece that makes it all the other pieces fit together. And suddenly, you can see a beautiful picture. When we're reading scripture, that's what we're seeing. We're seeing a picture of Christ and his redemptive work in this world, of drawing you and me and anyone who feels the call of God, who listens and understands that God is wanting to draw them to him in a relationship that's everlasting. He created the world, and we see through that creation. We see in his word the story of redemption, and we see in Christ the fulfillment of it all. That's the God we worship. That's the God who leaves the 99 to find the one, and we've all been that one. All of us have had God chase after us. We've all had God bring us back when we were heading to the fences. That's the kind of God we serve. That's the kind of God we worship. He orchestrates every event in your life, and he gives you those best chances to get to know him. Many of them, it's not just one, to experience the full measure of his love. It's the process of the relationship. And folks, that's why we're here. We're here to worship him, get to know him better. As Penny said in Sunday school, to get to know one another, to learn from each other's experiences, to be in his word, and to understand his word. Ministry is more than just a preaching time. It's a time of fellowship. It's a time of Bible study. It's a time of sharing with one another. Commit to seek him as he is seeking after you with all his heart. Let's stand and close in prayer. Lord, as we make this goal to deepen our relationship with you, I pray that somewhere in this sermon, that our hearts were grabbed, that our hearts are moved to worship you more deeply than we ever have before, to be able to come before you and just let it out, Lord. Teach us how to do that, just to let it out, to truly worship you. And I pray, Lord, that our prayer life will deepen, our study time will deepen in your word, that we'll truly be changed by your mighty power. Lord, go with each one today. I pray a blessing upon each person here. Lord, I just thank you for all you're doing in this congregation and in this chapel. Go with each one of us. Bless our families and bless each one, that we will all grow in our relationship with you. We pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Pretty day. We need to continue to ask God to bless America. I don't know you all whether you watched this fiasco that went on this week, but I did. And I don't know who's right, but I do know who's wrong. Our government is wrong. That judicial committee was wrong. All of this stuff could have been done without putting these two people through hell. And we need to ask God to straighten this government. Let's continue to ask God to bless America.
fight with foes.